So there is no wild forest anymore. There are only ecosystems that have been altered by our activities. And so in order to manage those lands, you have to be on the ground. You have to know them. You have to know the people. You have to know the desires of the national public as well as the local public. And you have to engage people in the management of that land because they're interested in it. It is, after all, their land.
Everything is so linked together. One thing will have an effect on another thing. And once you get into a chaos problem, there's never going to be a perfect answer.
We need to create a new way of managing public lands. We need to do something different. And it does not mean doing nothing. I don't think we have that choice.
All civilizations in the world have failed when their land masses have failed, and we are rapidly letting ours fail. We can no longer say that we are happy with 1.5% of our population taking care of the land. It's not healthy for the land, it's not healthy for the people.
We're not managing for goals now. You know, we're not managing with goals at all. It's just a big fight.
In the 1800s, cut-and-run lumber operations devastated large chunks of America's forests. By 1891, Congress had come around to the idea that some of the nation's lands, in addition to the national parks, should be kept in public ownership and managed in the public interest. Now the United States Forest Service manages almost 10% of the nation's land, an area the size of California, Colorado, and New York combined. Half the precipitation in the West falls on these national forests. From the Second World War to about 1990, these national forests supplied a good chunk of the nation's timber and wood products. With the concept of multiple use, these forests supplied recreation as well. But with competing goals, interest groups were in conflict over logging, over roads, over wilderness, over who gets to do what, where. We've spent billions on planning and litigation.
The problem is that we've never been able to implement multiple use very well. As we made, say, wilderness withdrawals, as you started, say, dedicating particular land uses, it introduced conflicts, and we never had a way to resolve those conflicts.
The groups that are successful in the public involvement process are the groups that polarize it. That means there's huge incentives to polarize and few incentives to come together.
And that's when things become expensive. Just alone, litigation can cost anywhere from $40,000 to $80,000 per project. And if we lose in court, there's a whole nother $100,000 that goes to attorney fees. The risk that a line officer has to take when making a decision is whether or not it will be appealed. And that's why we end up with such a big document.
Trust is a gigantic issue.
And finally, I think, to a certain extent, that the Forest Service began to clinch like a fighter under a barrage and just say, okay, well, what we're going to do is just try to keep from getting hurt here. And more, I think that's become the objective of the Forest Service, which isn't what anybody wants.
A lot of folks are very risk-averse. That's understandable. But the result is doing nothing seems to be a safe course. Well, we're finding out doing nothing doesn't follow that it's a safe course. Take the spotted owl. The population numbers are falling. Biscuit fire in the Siskiyous destroyed more than 500,000 acres of habitat. Spotted owl habitat is gone by the fire, not from logging, but by the fire.
We certainly haven't given the Forest Service those incentives as to do what's best for everything.